Okay, I'm going to get us started. Hopefully this is not too loud. Thank you so much for coming and taking part in our Distinguished Lecture, Scholar Lecture Series. This is our inaugural year. One of the things that we discussed in the graduate school this past year was the idea of having our own sort of scholarly program. And one of the ideas that came out of that was the idea of actually bringing a scholar to the campus, not only a scholar that has been distinguished in their research, which is what we have today, but also a scholar that also is a tremendous mentor. And in this case, in many cases, we're thinking being a mentor to PhD students and being able to bring that knowledge to campus. Although, in this case, too, we have a person as a mentor to PhD students and also a mentor in the way of mentoring other administrators, because that happens to be, you know, the major genesis of his research. So with that, we bring the Distinguished Scholar Lecture Series is actually to bring one of these individuals to campus and have them engage with students and scholars in the area in one event. So we actually had a breakfast this morning with a really engaged group. So I think I see some faces that were there today, so I thank you for that. We have the scholar give a lecture, which this is the lecture, and then we have individual meetings through the day, and we try our best to make them feel quite at home here in southern Florida. So particularly those that come from Madison, they feel pretty much at home this time of year. So with that, I'm going to introduce our distinguished scholar mentor. And I actually have some notes here, but it's very much pro forma because I know Dr. Jackson for over a decade now and in many different ways. So, but his title, as I said earlier this morning, is probably as long as my title, so I've got to take some notes here. So Dr. Jerlando F.L. Jackson is the Villis Distinguished Professor of Higher Education at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He also serves as the coordinator for the Higher Post-Secondary and Continuing Education Program and as a faculty affiliate for the Wisconsin Center for the Advancement of Post-Secondary Education. I was actually discussing with him when he founded his own lab, which has really taken off over the last 5 years, and he's director of that lab. It's the Wisconsin Equity and Inclusion Lab, which are called the WE Lab, I think is what it's called. WE Lab. So Dr. Jackson has over 100 publications. He's had over 175 presentations in his area. He got his Bachelor's of Education from University of Southern Mississippi, his Master of Education from Auburn University, and PhD in Higher Education at Iowa State. We are both from the same southern region of the United States, so I gave him a hard time last night because the pollen is working on the sinuses. it's a lot out there right now. So it gives me just so much pleasure to bring him here because we've actually had a number of fun research projects together. So it's just a delight. As an African American person that participates in higher administration, he's probably the primary person that I reach out to whenever I have to make a decision about my life, about things that I do in the job, the way in which my existence flavors the job. So that all, and again, brings the light for me to kind of have him here to kind of share that with you. So without any further delay, I'm going to bring Dr. Jackson to the stage. So please give him a round of applause.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to be here for all the reasons that he said with the wonderful weather. But I'd like to say that I consider Dean Blake a very good colleague. And it's definitely one of those calls I always answer, be sure to return if I'm not available. Because of the work that he has done at Georgetown and Notre Dame and now the work that he's doing here, but what he represents to the field in general and the work that he's been able to do in his academic field of computer science. I'm also excited as well because this morning's event was, I thought, very rich in discussion, and it was nice to be able to participate in having that exchange dialogue. So I appreciate those that made their time to get there this morning. And so I'm expecting to have a good opportunity to hear at this portion of the day, and then I'm looking forward to my meeting with some of you I can see in the room now, so I'm excited for that as well. But today, my talk will largely be a nested and a book that I did responding to the fact that at the time that I worked on this book, that there weren't any books on administrative color that was nested in data or used any type of systematic way of thinking about the work. Most of the books at that time were reflective essays of individuals who had been in administration, likely from other disciplines, and they were reflecting on their experiences. And I remember going to Josie Vass about this particular book, and they asked the question, was the literature on administrators of color mature enough to support a book? And it took a little bit of convincing, but I felt like it was time for a statement like that to occur, and so we were able to accomplish this textbook. On another note, I'm actually finishing a book on measuring glass ceiling effects, and that's one of the other projects I've been working on, where we've been looking at glass ceiling effects for women and people of color in an academic workplace. And this particular book actually proposes that institutions are proactive and systematic about looking at whether glass ceiling effects are occurring on their campus and thinking about ways they may be able to remedy them. But in all discussions that deal with creating a more equitable and diverse workplace, or a place to come and learn, you begin with the question around how vital diversity and representation across a number of metrics is on campus. There's a body of work now, largely driven out of response necessary from the Michigan Supreme First Court case, that really it helps explain the benefits, the educational benefits of diversity in the classroom in particular, and that's significant, but also outside of the classroom in ways that we're now beginning to understand in higher education, that business has already understood in ways because they can link their outcomes to profit, and profit can drive them to do things that maybe their heart may not. So in higher education, though, being able to understand the value of what diverse thinking brings to a particular space is an area that all our institutions can do a much better job of, and for those of us that want to make sure that message is communicated, that we too can think about more strategic ways for that to occur. But the learning in the classroom is significantly enriched because our students are exposed to not only the differential life experiences that come to play in the classroom, but the different cognitive ways in which you might respond to a question. Being exposed to a counterpoint to your point in some ways will always at least open your mind a little bit, particularly if you're open to that. And then lastly, calling institutions to task to recognize that their mission statements do in almost every single case say that they are contributing to the citizenry of the United States. So, and now the globe. And so with that being said, if we are graduating individuals who cannot appropriately contribute to the world that we live in and the space that we have in the United States, it's problematic. And for those that are specifically monitoring the progress or the lack thereof that we have in institutions of higher education, there's increased concern about access to it, not only as students, but also those that our professionals on campus to these wonderful places. I mean, these are, you know, there's a good reason that working at universities and professor roles and other types of roles tend to rank very high on the career metric system, and it's because there's a great unique value to these types of places and what they can be if we realize our full potential. But there's healthy concern about the motivation around why institutions are thinking about diversity and what they're actually doing and what it means when they put it in mission statements and make it a part of major agenda items of campaign and strategic planning. And then specifically, you know, it's very difficult to get away from this discussion around structural diversity. That, you know, from a structural standpoint, when you don't see a institution that is reflective in ways to the state, the city, the nation, and the world, you know, it should make you question to what extent are we preparing our students to be competitive in those spaces. And then lastly, in kind of these introductory remarks, is that universities do tend to think about what's going on with students, and in some cases faculty, but the spaces that oftentimes we don't spend a lot of attention to is administrators. How are we cultivating the leadership on campus, and whether the leadership is linked from a transition from faculty into an academic leadership role, or in what ways are we making undergraduate students aware that they're the viable career as higher education practitioners. So as you think about why it's necessary to have this discussion or a project of this nature, I can take you to one point. We look here at the representation of people of color in administrative workforce and higher education, drawing on the national data that we have out of our National Center for Education Statistics. You'll see that approximately 17% of the full-time administrators will fall into a category of color. And then almost 83% are going to be white administrators. And so there's a significant gap in those moving to the roles. And we have a body of work that I'll reference throughout my presentation that really calls institutions the task to think about why might that be the case, especially at former white institutions, and are we thinking about the types of intentional or unintentional discriminatory practices that may be the cause for what we realize in these particular spaces. For quite some time now, the media outlets that monitor what goes on in higher education, including the Chronicle, Diverse, and others that are now on the horizon, has called the question, why is it that we aren't thinking about diversity across the institution and not eliminating the senior most positions? Why aren't we including those into discussion as well? Very specific things that I wanted to address that I will talk about in the presentation, and it goes in much deeper discussion in the book, is that I want to understand in what ways institutions were actually diverse in administrative ranks. What are some of the barriers that administrators of color experience, as well as what are some of the normal coping strategies to work within these particular environments? Lastly, what institutional approaches tend to yield the best practices when we think about increasing diversity within the workforce? there are several guiding concepts that led to the formation of this project. The first one is representative bureaucracy. So many of you who are political scientists would be familiar with this concept that's linked to a lot of ways of public representation and voter dynamics, and it's rooted around this whole notion that if you share some characteristics with those that you're making decisions on, you're more likely to push forward decisions and efforts that would be consistent with their needs and expectations. And going further with where we're sort of situating the discussion here today is that representation would also be thinking about the across diversity metrics as well. And then there's two ways in which representative bureaucracy finds expression. The first is a passive representation where the representatives share the same characteristics. So there's this belief that if you share similar characteristics, you will also potentially have like needs. Now we know that's not absolute. And then the second is that when there aren't any shared characteristics, that individuals are actively committed to understanding the needs, expectations of constituents, that there's an active process for gathering information and using that to help be a representative of that particular organization. The second is trying to understand the whole body working around retention. And the rationale for bringing this into the process is that, you know, we tend to feel like we understand what it means to appropriately retain a student, like you want them to graduate, right? That you got a really clear metric. And then for faculty, at least the historical perspective was that you would keep them forever, right? That's not always the case nowadays. But you at least got, in the initial promotion and hierarchy, you have these ranks in which that you can begin to frame around, well, what does it mean to retain them? Can we support them through the promotion and tenure process? Can we get them to senior professor roles? And then can we continue to grow to allow them to think about how they might see their career at a place and keep them? But we don't quite have the same process when we think about administrators. Like, is it good to have an administrator for 25 years? I mean, that's not the trend now, but it has occurred. Like, can a leader be in place for 40, 30 years in a senior level role and continue to respond to the demand? So it's just the whole notion about what it means. Is it bad to lose a top leader to another institution because they cannot find upward mobility? Some perspective may be good that you develop the talent and provide the support system for them to go off and do it because they couldn't do it there. But one other perspective is that, well, you know, maybe we haven't quite done our job and we weren't able to keep them. So we don't have the same ways of thinking about what's appropriate retention around administrators. And then the third is this three-tier approach to institutional diversity, that, you know, we have this three-tier strategy, and it lays out in this pyramid format, and the pyramid represents really the overall composition on campus, with the largest body of individuals being students, then faculty, and administrators. And that in this context, that the notion is that, one, we understand that we want students that are representative of the community that we'd like them to go out and serve, and then that we understand that if you look at the literature around faculty-student interaction, that one of the key indicators around not only attracting students, but retaining them toward graduation is just faculty-student interaction. Sometimes it's around undergraduate research, which we hear a lot about, but other times it could just be developing a sustainable relationship that allows those students to connect in ways because they connect with someone that will share opportunities with them. And so the role of faculty in creating experience for students is very significant and may be under appreciated. And then the administrators clearly is around trying to develop and implement policy, and that if you don't have this three-tiered strategy, that you could be overrepresented or not represented very well in some area. That you got students, but there's no faculty of diverse backgrounds. You got students and you got faculty of diverse backgrounds, but no one in the leadership roles provide the type of support necessary when you do run into particular challenges, because there's going to be challenges, and if you don't have, going back to this representative bureaucracy, individuals in leadership roles that are in are attuned to the different challenges that diverse backgrounds or underrepresented groups could bring with them, how do you appropriately respond? So with this project, when we did this project, it was an integrated research review on where we pulled our work. And at the time of this particular project, there were 136 studies that were done with administrators of color as a unit of analysis. There was 38 studies that focused on administrators of color in other areas that were not higher ed. And then there were 48 studies that were on topics that were complementary to this particular project. And then I used two national data sets to supply some data that I'll share with you in a moment. One that outlines really the academic leadership roles of the institution, and those would be coming with individuals that have faculty appointment that went through the chair role, assistant associate dean, provost, and chancellor. And then we use the National Association for Student Personnel Administrator salary survey data that has a ton of demographic variables in it to understand similar dynamics on the student affairs side of the house. So we didn't have one database that had both sets there. So if you think about if you ask the question about the status of diversity on these institutions, let's talk a little bit about what the data would show. And I have to say before I go into this, I had a really nice conversation with Dean Blake last night, and he talked about the emphasis on international research and affairs of Miami. And so I actually added some comparative data to it from the UK to get a sense last night, so you get a sense of how we compare to another country. And I chose the UK because I've been doing some work in the UK, so I was able to pull that data much easier. While I do understand you all have a major emphasis in South America, this is a UK comparative piece. So when you look at the US academic workforce and compare it to the UK, you'll see that administrators of color in both the US and UK is, in the US is approximately 10%, and this is the academic side, so the first data point I showed you was combined. This is breaking out just those on academic leadership side of the institution. And then in the UK, they're doing just slightly better, but not much more at almost 30%. And then as you look at gender here, you'll see that men are significantly represented in the US at 63%, and then still so in the UK, but at 55%. And that that women in both contexts are over 50% of the support staff in both contexts, right? So support staff in both contexts is majority of female. Now, I'm going to talk about something that you're going to say, well, why do we need to know about age? And I'm going to get to that. So here's an analysis by age, academic leadership side. And here you'll see what the average age is in both the U.S. and in the U.K. So see, the U.K. is a little shorter, right? Part of that is attributable to the degree process is far more compressed in the U.K. You can get an undergrad degree structured in 3 years. And then how they think about the doctorate degree is a little different than the way we think about it here. So we have built-in time that will be a much longer investment in your degree process here versus there. So I do want to put that out there. But then the largest category in the U.S. is age 45 to 55. And so this is going into leadership roles. So if you remember what I said, this is an academic leadership side of the institution. So these are faculty members who have assumed leadership roles very early in their career. And what that tends to do is have long-term effects, right? First is, the earlier you enter the academic leadership, the less likely your focus on research can be the same. And the less likely you are to not be a full professor if you do it immediately upon that process. And so then it takes much longer to be a full professor. Because even though you may be asked to take these roles on, there may be some spaces, but the ones that I'm familiar with, they don't have a way to accommodate that service in toward the promotion. So you're doing a great service to the institution, but in some cases a disservice to your ability to be a full professor. And then on top of that, it diminishes your research momentum. Right? So if you stop it, it's like starting all over. Particularly if you if your research is around relationships, data access relationships. Well, if those relationships go away and the season change, you got to reestablish them. And maybe the techniques pass you by. And before you know it, re-jumping and jump-starting becomes very difficult. So as people of color, we sit in that associate professor role far longer than our colleagues. Okay? Now, I give you a story on this. When I had got tenure, my department was trying to convince me to be the department chair. So I pulled out an article and I said, did you read my last article? You are asking me to go against good empirical data. I said, so you all promote me to full professor, I can do this. Yeah. But until then, and I say this very clearly, this is the work of a full professor. And until I'm a full professor, let's not have this discussion again. And they had nothing else to say because I had the data. I said, you can't ask me to do what we already know is a challenge. And then if I did it, you're not going to give me any credit for it. You're just going to be glad that you don't have to do it. So then, average income for full-time academic leaders, U.S., U.K. So on average, the academic leaders in the U.S. at 67, and then in the U.K. is a little less, and that's a converted factor. But what you'll see here is that your counterpart, white and Asia-Pacific Islanders, and that's a very specific governmental classification, it's 20% more. Now, mind you, these are faculty salaries. The base, so that's 20% more on a 9-month base. That could be pretty significant, right? And all other ethnic and racial groups were below each, so there's a 20% gap at Miller. And again, you got in this context, the top part of the slide impacts the salary because you might be dealing with associate professor salary, and in some cases, you'd be surprised, there are some assistant professors out here that are department chairs, and associate deans, and a host of other things. I guess I got another story I could tell later about that, but I won't do it now. So, also, as we go a little further about distribution of the data around diversity, so we look across the ranks. So, white and Asian Pacific Islanders have a higher proportion of their full professors. Blacks, African Americans, and Asians are the higher proportion of their associate professors. And then here you'll see blacks also have a large proportion. So of assistant professors, they're the largest proportion in that particular category. And then in other, in this other, which could be anything, clinical, non-tenure track, you name it, lecturer, there's a host of titles depending on where you are. You have Hispanic is the largest proportion in that particular category. So again, that has implications for what occurs or can occur in the academic workplace. So the other area is disciplinary backgrounds. And here you can see this is very supportive of things that we hear about, that people of color largely in education, humanities, and so on. And the only thing I'll say about this part is that in moving to academic leadership roles, your disciplinary background can impact how high up you can go in the hierarchy. And that can cut across institutional type as well. That there's a particular mindset of who and from what disciplinary background could approach. And oftentimes, the engagement and participation in external funded research having a relationship with the major funding governmental agencies is usually one of the criteria used, because the provost plays a significant role in negotiating those indirect costs if there's a time to renegotiate them. So having someone in that role with that type of experience usually plays a significant role there. The science parts of campus tend to have an advantage because their world is funding research, so they speak that language in ways that some faculty across the campus will. And then academic administrators of color across the institutional types. And here you'll see, in a lot of ways, what you've probably heard already, and that's certain groups are more likely to get research institutions, while others are not. And some groups are likely to be in a small liberal arts setting context versus not, right? So these are different faculty lifestyles and different students, as well as a public-private dynamic. And this is helpful. This section of the book is helpful for those that are trying to understand the types of places that they might better fit, right? Because unfortunately, in many of these programs where we prepare people to go off and get PhDs, the mindset is you should be at this type of place. That type of place may not be the place for you. That may not be where your skills are best used or you are best served. And I hope I get a chance to talk about some other work that we've done where it's very clear that fit is probably the biggest factor in the career mobility and satisfaction for underrepresented groups. So just a little bit about student affairs data. Here you'll see something very interesting. the gender gap is reversed in student affairs work. I see some heads nodding, so you probably already knew this. But some of you might didn't know that when you look at the distribution by gender, you'll see that females hold these positions at a larger percentage rate than their males. And what you didn't know in the last set of data that I did say, there's one group where the females have outpaced the males in active leadership roles, and that's African American and blacks. That women are in those roles in a higher percentage than males now. The switch happened about early 1990s. Before that, it was teetering, almost balanced, and then a shift occurred, and then that there's an upward trend there. It doesn't look like it's gonna go any other direction. Some other trends that may be relevant in employment for student affairs is that blacks, African Americans, and Asian Pacific Islanders are likely to be present at two-year institutions in leadership roles. So the largest number of diverse, outside of HBCUs, the largest number of diverse presidents are coming out of two-year colleges, right? And if you look proportionally, Hispanic serving institutions have a unique dynamic because they're likely a predominantly white institution first that met the percentage distribution to be classified. So the chances are that the president there is still a white president, even though it's a Hispanic serving institution. And then as far as private versus public institutions, you'll see that the distribution here is pretty commensurate in those ways. And it's kind of reflective of two things. One is that private institutions on one hand have a great deal of flexibility on how they do hiring, right? They could do target hiring in some very specific ways. So there are some advantages there. But then in the reverse, and these data are prior to recent decisions, a reaffirmation in the Supreme Court that could change what this looks like at public institutions, where there was a strong emphasis in trying to uphold diversity practices in employment and in students. Probably to no surprise to anyone in this room, that location matters when it comes to diversity. And if you take this map, and for those of you that go to NASPA, it was the easiest map to use, of the United States, and you lay on top of that the distribution by race ethnicity at the institutions by state, you'll see a really neat overlay where that generally the diversity in the surrounding communities in many ways helps determine the kind of diversity you'll see represented on the campus, right? So if you're in the Southeast where there's more African Americans or black, that's where you see the largest concentration. So that's what you see here by the respective areas. And so you can see by each group where they're most likely to be located at the university, and they'll also be most likely to be located in the general population in those areas of the country. So what are some legal concepts and frameworks that help to understand what we see when we don't see a workplace or an environment that we think may be commensurate with the diversity in these communities? So one is affirmative action. And you know, affirmative action is clearly under attack, but what role it did play and can continue to play is that it did provide the opportunity to craft policies and practices to correct prior discriminatory practices. Judgment impact theory I spoke about, so I'll move on. Underutilization analysis. So you might not even recognize that your institution does this, but your EEOC office does this. And if you've done a search, and sometimes if you pay real close attention to the bottom, there's a box, and it says, gender, underutilized. Yes, no. Race, ethnicity, underutilized. Yes, no. What that means is that they've done an analysis of the available talent and the presence in the workplace, and that there's an actual underutilization of what's available, right? So underutilization actually narrows the consideration pool to those that are actually eligible. When we talk about under and over representation, we make a lot of assumptions. We look at a broad number and assume that everyone with a PhD wants to be a college president. And we say that there's an underrepresented. It might not be underrepresented because, or it might be overrepresented depending on once you figure out who's actually qualified, or who's qualified, who's interested, and so the underutilization actually takes a different strategy on this. And then, you know what, I think I skipped something. I thought that was a representative argument. So disparate impact theory is actually a legal analysis that allows the university to think about if your practices, the hiring, the way you structure, the way you put together your search committees, whether you use a search firm, whether something in that process disproportionately impacts a particular group. And so one way you can think about this is if there was a way to take the University of Miami, the U, right, and take and create a map, and map from senior level to the bottom, every position, and then I plot gender and race, ethnicity, and if I see large concentration and I see large openings, we might be beginning the discussion of a desperate impact. And desperate impact does not care about intent, right? It doesn't matter if you didn't intend to do it, you still did it. And it's straightforward. And then glass ceiling effect, and this is a glass ceiling, so this is trying to understand the set of non-job related variables that can predict your presence or not in a particular position. And the glass ceiling, in the truest sense, is only the senior level position and above. And that you must show that the probability of selection will decrease over time. Right, so it can't just be a general inequity that began in a lower level position, and there's 5% of a group at the lower level, and that just follows that group throughout. It has to be that you had a 50% chance of getting an entry level job, and then the mid level job, it went down to 5%, and you got a 1% chance of making it to senior level. That shows that over time that the probability of selection is decreased significantly, which is distinctly different on how the term is often used for a short-term value. But if you look at some of the things that we're doing, we're trying to really help communicate that glass ceiling is a unique form of discrimination, not a description of general inequity, so that it doesn't lose its meaning. But then also try to understand both from a quantitative and qualitative perspective, how do you find the presence of that in your institution to help signal to the institution that they have to also look at the senior most level positions on campus as well. So barriers. How much time I have?
As long as you like. But if you could,
I would become very efficient because you might already know the barriers. So here are the barriers. this kid to hear. So the barriers, we lay these barriers out across three different domains. We talk about the barriers and they neatly fit in both a social barriers that have that impacts and link to the organizational barriers, because all universities, we're part of society. So what happens before you cross into the university, the way you think out there is the way you might bring it here. We assume that when you come into the academy, you put on your intellectual hat and all of the academic morals that come with that, that you are a better you here than you might be out there. But we understand that you still bring some of that. And then the individual barrier, right? So when you look at this kind of work, a good portion of the literature is focused on the internal dynamics that administrators of color deal with moving in and through a university, right? And that's this double jeopardy that women of color deal with, and a host of other challenges, as well as this whole body of work that talks about imposter syndrome. Do I belong here? Am I in a position that's truly empowered, or am I just here to be at the table? You know, the internal struggles of I'm here to help, but can I really help? Right. That is as significant as the institutional barriers that are levied and put into this centric circle. And the interaction between the organizational barriers and the internal barriers equals your workplace experience, right? So to the extent that the university has thought about the ways in which the institution has or has not created an appropriate and conducive environment for you to do your work and be productive in your work, along with how you have either through institutional support or self-support figured out how you persevere through some very challenging times. I have some other studies where if I had the time, I could talk about this internal barrier dynamic, because in most cases, the internal barrier dynamics, institutions don't do a good job of helping of diverse groups move through the most challenging parts of their career, and that's getting a job. The most difficult thing is to get the job, right? Then the next most difficult thing is to move from your entry-level role, whether that's an entry-level administrative role or assistant professor, to being a social professor. And that journey usually weeds out a significant portion of those available. And the support for that from the institution is often always lacking. But when you look at the story of those that were successful, they found self-agency to get through that piece. And then when you look at those on the other end, the spectrum of opportunities, once you become a full professor, it is vast. Because it's vast because you're one of two. You're one of three. And so the lean gratification to make it through, but most people don't make it through. And I know that's not, I didn't have time to talk about that, but that one box, I was gonna put a pin on it and say, that is very significant. And if you haven't thought about that and how you are making decisions about where you wanna work, or how you work wherever you are, understand that internal barrier and how it intersects with the organizational barrier, the internal one is the one that you can control, affects your workplace experience. Strategies that are known to help: leadership programs. Leadership programs have been helpful, mostly for networking possibilities, right? It's not that you're going to get in these roles, these programs, and learn something you already know. It's that you're going to have access to a pool of potential mentors, but most critically, sponsors, right? You can't get the big job without a sponsor, right? Because we call it, like I said, I'm just on the provost search. You give us five, but we're going to call some other, we're going to call some other ones. And it's the other ones. They can't just be references. If there's no sponsors in the pool, you're going to be in another pool, and another pool, and another pool. And mentoring matters. Mentoring is the one consistent strand throughout the literature that says it helps. And it helps for a lot of reasons. It helps for exposure to the basic information you need. The academy is not a traditional career. So they didn't learn about this at the family picnic unless your family business is the academy. You know, so the academic mindset and the atmosphere is a learned space. And it's more difficult for some to learn and figure it out than others. But it's a unique environment. And everyone has to learn how it operates. Then institutional support. Institutions can do far more than they do. But institutions do a lot that we don't take advantage of. And that includes, you know, do you have support? If you need a support group, is there, are there support groups? If there aren't any, do you need to self-organize? Or are you going to wait for the institution to do it? The same is true for networking opportunities. You know, are you a part of every option that when a speaker comes to campus or an event comes to campus, are you in there with your business card trying to meet these individuals? Are you asking to be on the agenda? Are you taking full advantage? When you go to these conferences, what do? Is it purely to enjoy whatever city you're in and go to them? Are you not in the hallways networking? Are you not at the reception? It's not just for food. Right? Or do you peruse the exhibit hall and only look at books you're going to buy? Well, guess what? Guess what other people are doing? They're negotiating book contracts. They're not going in there trying to figure out, am I going to buy Blake's new book? You're in there saying, you're shopping your book idea around. And the acquisition editor is almost always there. So, let me touch a few of these things and I'm almost done. So, institutional support is very critical. And so this is kind of to the university. Come correct, when you are trying to create a diverse environment, you have to understand supply and demand, and you have to understand market value. What most universities don't understand is they have not been in the business of recruiting and retaining diverse groups, so they don't understand the market value. You cannot take the same strategy when you try to find one person and there's 250,000 of them. You can't do it. If it's one of five, you need to know what the market is. How much other four making? That's the market. That is the real market. And that's why certain institutions always miss out on the first opportunity. Or you lose them later. You have to be ready to understand that you have the one of five everybody wants. I mean, I could go in this room and say, how many of you at your level across the country? And you have to take a while, and you might come up with, maybe you come up with 10, maybe less. Well, everybody wants all 10 of you. So I cannot recruit you in the same way if you're just readily available. But at the same time, I have to value what you're going to bring that the 250 may or may not bring to understand that that's the investment that needs to be made. All right. So then the engagement, retention, advancement model. So I guess I'm talking to Dean Blake here. I guess I need to turn this way. So, and I'm speaking on behalf of everybody in the room. So when you do this work, you got to be systematic. You got to understand that the pre-engagement is as important as bestowing this endowed chair on them later in their life. That the way you interact with them, bringing them to campus, sets the stage. It defines if they want to spend the rest of their life with you. It's like dating, right? And we know if the courtship is not what you think it is, it's not going to get much better. That's the best book. That's everything that's good about you as an institution right there. And so if you drop the ball on scheduling something, or you forget to return a call, like, to you, it was just one other thing you didn't do right, because you know you have 150, but that's the one thing that they know, because that's the only relationship they got with you right now, that they did not get my reimbursement check to me. Or that I have to have a reimbursement check because I'm an enemy. Like, okay, so if you can't prepay for this now, you can't pay for it later, I need to remember that. And if I need, so that means that first thing I need to understand is how financially sound this is going to be. I guess I'm helping them negotiate now. All right, I'm going to bring it to close so I can get some questions and answers. But, you know, the book, if you get a chance to read it, I mean, it really does a pretty interesting job of thinking systematically about what we have available in the workplace, what are the known challenges, what strategies have worked, and how might we be more systematic in it. The book can be read in two ways. Three ways. One, if you're just an intellectual scholar, you know, this can help you to research. Two, if you are a person that sees yourself as moving through the environment, it helps you understand the challenges there. And then for those that are on the other end trying to hire, recruit, and cultivate, it gives you signals to say, we need to be paying attention to these types of things to make our institution a very attractive place to be. I'll have some cards available here, and I'm able to take questions as long as you all want to ask them.
Yeah. Hopefully you agree that that was... Thank you.